be is my favorite hymn. And I've never heard it like that. It's really good. And also my second favorite hymn is In Christ Alone, even though it's incredibly Calvinist. I love that hymn. Google that if you don't know what I mean by that. In your bulletin, real quick, is a letter from Steve Edwards, a member of our church who will be working a Kairos prison on April 21st and 24th. I urge you to give to this, especially for the meal tickets, but also cookies and placemats, posters and prayers, anything else you can give. Kairos is a great ministry. We've reduced prayer in school to a moment of silence if we're lucky. And we've significantly reduced the amount of time that Jesus Christ can be presented to people. So on the other side of it is, instead of doing it in the schools, we have to do it in the prisons. So please give to this endeavor. Also on the back of that is a full listing that Catherine has put together of Holy Week, March 20th through 27th, as we get ready for Easter. So please notice that. If you would, I want you to turn in your Bibles to Exodus 17, 5. It's also in the pew racks in front of you. Our scripture today records the time when the Lord met a great need for the children of Israel as they wandered in the desert to the promised land. The Lord answered Moses, "Go out in front of the people. Take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go." You notice he said go twice. He must have been pretty serious. Verse 6, "I will stand there before you by the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it for the people to drink." So Moses did this in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and because they tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" This is the word of God for the people of God, and all God's people said.
Thanks be to God.
Going through the Lord's Prayer, you get a lot of curious phrases. You get "Our Father." You can't really pray that until you've been adopted by God and sealed by the Holy Spirit until you've been born again. Second is "Hallowed be thy name." You can't just mutter that and then go off as if our lives are not affected by that, as if we aren't an active participant in hallowing the name of the Lord with everything that we are and everything that we have. Then we get to "Thy kingdom come," which means that the Lord sits on the throne of our hearts and we listen to Him and we follow His lead. We get to "Thy will be done," and that means that we seek His will and do His will. And often His will is done because of us instead of in spite of us, if we're living correctly. And now we get to "Give us this day." Jesus' disciples asked Him about prayer, and He responded to that request, and He teaches them this prayer. It's got basically six petitions. Scholars can get in fights about this, but basically it's six petitions. Three petitions express our passion to know God, His name, His kingdom, and His will. And then there are three petitions that express our dependence on God: daily bread, forgiveness of sins, and deliverance from evil. And we get to these first of these three petitions. "Give us this day our daily bread." The first word there is "give." Now, why in the world would He choose that word? Because Jesus knew that the Lord is the source of everything that we have. And a lot of times we don't think about that. Everything that you have, everything that you have been given by the Lord at some level. Now, some of us have done well. Some of us have developed our talents and taken risks and all this. But just think for a moment. What if God had made you less intelligent? What if God had given you less initiative? What if God had made you not as much of a problem solver? How would your life have been different? What if that chance meeting had not happened? And I'm not talking about this simplistic theology of, you know, "there but by the grace of God goes I." That's a little bit simplistic. I'll get to that in another sermon. I'm talking about absolute, total dependence on the gifts of the Lord. The way you have danced with Him throughout your life, and you have shared with him in balancing your faithfulness and his faithfulness, excuse me, and your obedience. How has that changed your life? Who is your provider? Do we often look at our jobs as providers? Do we look at that government contract we're bidding on? Is there a panic that sets into our hearts when we may not get the contract? We so rarely see the loss of a contract, even a job, as God merely changing the source of his blessing. But the Lord is still the source, whatever means he uses. And since he is, and since we know this, we can come to him with the right attitude as receivers, because he is the source. Then you've got, give us this day our daily bread. The pronoun here is not me. Give me my daily bread. It's plural. And I don't want to get into a lot of collectivist, Marxist, theological whatnot here, but just stay with me. We are not entirely focused on ourselves. We are concerned about others, or should be, if we're going to pray this prayer with integrity. What is the greatest commandment? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. And neighbor does not just mean family or the person that is physically living next to you. It's everybody who doesn't have enough bread. Third word in this, or phrase in this case, is this day. Give us this day our daily bread. Are you focused on this day? Are you focused on the moment? Or are you focused on tomorrow? And I don't want to get into a bunch of, well, we really shouldn't plan this sort of, you know, weird, crazy theology some people come up with sometimes. I'm talking about, are you unhealthily or in an unholy way focused on tomorrow? I am focused way too much on tomorrow and next week and next month. Next year, right now I'm focused on March 21st. I can't wait to have that surgery. I'm not in pain or anything, but I'm tired of hopping around like I'm 96 years old. Really, that don't hurt. I'm just scared I'm going to tear something. But anyway, how about you? Are you living in the future instead of living in the present? Are you living in some kind of unholy way? You know, if we focus too much on tomorrow, I don't care what anybody says, it always devolves into worry. Every single time you can make, I've made every excuse in the book, and you can make whatever excuse in the book that you want to. You are driven by preoccupation and worry. It's give us this day. Now, Corrie ten Boom, who actually did stuff with her life, she saved, hid Jews from Nazis during World War II and went to the concentration camp for it, and lost her sister in the concentration camp. So she's someone who knows about worrying and coping with worry. She said this, worry does not empty tomorrow of its sorrow. It empties today of its strength. Worry, and I love this, she's so engineer when she says this. Worry is a cycle. Aha, engineering word. Worry is a cycle of inefficient thoughts. Inefficient, how engineer can you get? Worry is a cycle of inefficient thoughts whirling around a center of fear. We have not been sent a spirit of fear. We have been sent the Holy Spirit, and the Lord helps us this day. And you can see this as the Lord guides the children of Israel across Sinai, since we've talked about this. Exodus 16, the Lord says to Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you. And the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day, that I may prove to them whether they will walk in my law or not. Think about it. The Lord would prove to them by providing for them every single day. And if they went out and they tried to store it all up, what happened to it? Maggots. Maggots, maggots, maggots. The Lord provided manna. Also, Hebrew lesson that has almost nothing to do with the sermon. I don't know if you... The word manna in Jewish, Hebrew, is actually a phrase. It's actually a question. It's Hebrew for, what is it? Not kidding. Did you know that? So they go out into the desert, and there's this stuff on the ground. What is it? Well, we're just going to call it, what is it? But anyway, the provision is daily. Give us this day our daily bread. Now, the Greek word that Jesus uses there for daily is incredibly interesting. It is the word, I can't even pronounce it, epiousiosai. I usually do good at Greek. I'm at A in Greek, but not today. This is weird. There's hardly any other word like this used by the New Testament. And I'm not kidding when I say this. For 1,700 years, scholars looked at this word and they couldn't find it anywhere in Greek literature. And it really freaked them out. It really scared them to death. Some of them started thinking that the gospel writers made it up. And then they couldn't figure out why they made it up. So this is all very, very weird. And in the mid-20th century, there was an archaeological dig. And I don't know if you know this or not, but when you have archaeological digs and you find written material, you can find almost anything in the stack and pile and cache of written material. You can find manifest lists on ships. You can find gladiator rosters. One time they even found this letter from this spoiled brat of a young boy, just giving his father the what for not taking him with him on a trip. I mean, the letter even ended, I'm so mad at you, I could just die, and so there. I mean, the ancient Greek equivalent of that. But what they found in this archaeological dig was a grocery list. Grocery list, what does this have to do with the Bible? It had that word on it. That word they couldn't find for 1,700 years. And they realized that there were different classifications of groceries. There were sort of items that you could buy in bulk. Like if you went to Sam's, rice and salt and some kind of preserved foods. And there were preserved foods back then. And then there was sort of a mid-range thing. I don't remember what it was called. Things that you didn't buy in bulk, but you bought sort of every week. And then there was this third category on the list that the author of the list had called epiousiosis. And this category of items were things that had to be bought daily. In the case of this list, it was milk, fresh fruit, and meat. These were daily needs. And what do we learn from this? What I learned from this, I don't know about you, but I learned that the Lord cares about our daily needs. He is concerned with the ordinary humdrum of human life. And you may think, no, he doesn't. I've lived long enough. This bad thing happened. That bad thing happened. You know, one of the kids fell at school the other day and skinned her knee. And another one was called a name. And the kids were hurt. And Becca and I, we care about these little things. And stepping back and looking at the skint knee, it wasn't really a skint knee. I've had a skint knee. This was not a skint knee. This was a series of hatch marks on the surface of her knee epidermis, okay? And that might have drawn blood at a point or two. The name that was called, they called each other names every day, and the friend was having a bad day. This wasn't like, Hitler Youth had come and cursed my child or something. These were little things, and we kissed knees, and we hugged hearts, and all this stuff. And you may say, well, Church, of course you're worried about the little things in the life of your kid. You're their dad. That's my point. God has no grandchildren. The Lord only has children. He is convinced, he is concerned that the ordinary things of life are important, even the ones that are small, even the ones that are daily. His eye is on the sparrow, another great song that Grandma used to get down to. The very hairs on our heads are numbered. Of course, for some of us, the Lord's job is getting a little easier because we don't have as much hair as we used to, but the Lord cares about these things. Luke 12:7. Do not be afraid. You are worth more than any sparrows. Then you got bread. Give us this day our daily bread. He also uses bread to show us something here. That word symbolizes everything. It doesn't mean this concoction that we cooked up with flour, salt, and water, and maybe yeast if we're not Jewish. He means the very sustenance of life. And that includes the little things, and I think I've made that point. You see this provision for the children of Israel. In addition to food, they needed water. Remember the rules of three. 3 hours without shelter, 3 days without food, 3 weeks without, three hours without shelter, 3 days without water, 3 weeks without food, and 3 minutes without Wi-Fi. They didn't have Wi-Fi back then, but God decided not to invent it yet. Okay. Water is what they needed, and they camped in the wilderness. No water or drink that they could see. Once again, they're wrapped up in this inefficient cycle of fear, as not Whoopi Goldberg, Corrie ten Boom would say. And they were just giving Moses grief. And what is the Lord telling them? The Lord answered Moses, go out in front of the people, take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. And I will stand before you by the rock at Horeb, and strike the rock, and water will come out of it for the people to drink. And so Moses did this in the sight of the elders of Israel, and he called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled, and because they tested the Lord, saying, is the Lord among us or not? You know, we're just like them sometimes. We doubt the Lord's presence. We doubt the Lord's provision. We think that if God is with us, then we won't have any needs or any troubles or anything like that. This is not true. This is patently not true. God allows us to have needs that we might stand and see the salvation, his infinite supply, his infinite provision. And that is where we meet him, and that is where we depend on him daily. Another thing is he's striking the rock, and the sustenance comes out of the rock. Is Jesus your rock? You know, the biblical symbolism of Jesus is the rock and the foundation and all that, that's neat. But there's other uses of the word rock in the Bible. And this is one. Is Jesus your rock? You know, the theme of the entire Lord's Prayer is this, is the things of God comes first and everything else falls into place. Seek ye first his kingdom. What's his kingdom? It's the place where his will is done. In your personal life and mind, it's where he sits on the throne of our hearts. Seek to live there, and in all your daily needs, everything that you need for sustenance will be supplied. It doesn't mean don't work. It doesn't mean lay around on a couch. It means sit in the presence of God like that, and things will take care of themselves. And I could go on a long time about the difference between daily needs and daily wants. You should see my Amazon list. Do I actually need that stuff? At some point, I would like to have it. But this is not our Amazon list. Our purpose is to know Jesus. And what does he say? Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Let the day's own trouble be sufficient for the day. The Lord works daily. He works one step at a time. You might have a step to make. Maybe you need to follow Jesus with all of your heart and your mind and your soul and live beyond the kind of strange, sick, twisted worry that the world tries to peddle. Maybe that you need to learn to live in his daily provision. Maybe you need to give your life to him for the very first time. Others of you might need to give your life to him for the very last time and live forever in a commitment to him. If any of this is the case, I invite you to come forward on the first verse of the last hymn and kneel at this altar in response to his grace. The altar is softer today because of the love of many. This only happens once a year, so if you're here for a soft altar, come forward. Before we sing, let us pray again with integrity the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,